Outside, it's you know, what, the third week of October, and it's the weather's really. Am I getting a little reverb here, echo thing? Sound all right? Look, I'm good. Nobody's got anything. So I'm just thankful that I'm looking out, and you know, got up, and it's beautiful outside. It really is. It's you know, I mean, I'm thankful for. Really not looking forward to winter coming, but you know what, we need that as well, right? But it's beautiful outside today, and it's just, you know, when I look at the change in the colors of the leaves, and I don't know about you, but I think it's important to just kind of take that in. I see Jesus all in that. I don't know about you, but I see Jesus in the colors and the change. You know, he's such a variety God. Aren't you glad, you know, that not all the birds are brown, and he's got blue birds and yellow birds and red birds and pink birds, and you know, that's just the birds, not counting the flowers and you know, all the other variety. And so like them are just, you know, and all of that, just really all that says is like, you know, like if someone comes in your house, they'll say, oh, they got that picture on the wall, and oh, they got that there, and you kind of get the feeling of somebody's character by going to their house. You know what I'm saying? Linda just painted our bedroom. Well, we just got, I should say we helped. I helped her, but I didn't do one thing. But just kind of wondered what we're going to do with all the stuff that we moved out of the way. But it turned out beautiful. And it just, it's lovely. And I was laying there looking at it, and I was just, you know, I seen her character in that room. You know, she bought this little kind of leaf thing that has these different colors that kind of match the ceiling. She says, where do you think I should put this? Should I put it here, put it there? Well, maybe I'll get another one. We'll put one on each side. And what I'm saying is that it was like, it was her character. It was, I seen her impression on that wall. Do you know what I'm saying? I seen her. And when I look outside, that's what I think. I see God. I see his character. I see Jesus in color. I see Jesus in the nature all around me, and the birds and the things. And I say, man, he's such a diverse God. He's so awesome. He's so marvelous. He's so wonderful. And then, you know, I got up early this morning and walked outside, and don't know, this time of the year it seems especially, but the moon's just beautiful, huge, and the stars, and I'm looking up at it, and I'm not like thinking this right now, but it's going through my mind as I look up, and I'm like, wow, so beautiful out. And it's like, and I'm thinking about it right now, like here it is daytime, but at nighttime it shows God's diversity as well. Isn't that just neat? The stars and the moon, and all it says is, it says his character. It says that God is full of life, he's full of color, he's full of joy, he's full of, you know, all those things that we look at and we admire, that's God.
Amen.
And it's like you look at it, and what you're looking at is you're looking at God's pleasure, God's creation. You know, to me it just, you know, the Bible says that all the earth speaks of the glory of the Lord, and you know, really it does. When you take time to look at it, it does. But I'm thankful to be here today. I was looking at a verse here yesterday and a little bit this morning, and if you have your Bibles with me, it's a familiar verse in the Bible, actually chapter, Psalms 84. If you want to turn there with me. And I was thinking about, as the Lord had taken me to this chapter, the thought had been on my mind over the last week about, I don't know about you, but and even in myself, if I'm not careful, but it seems like there seems to be a, you know, and I guess the title would be, Only God Can Satisfy. Only God Can Satisfy, amen? And there seems to be such an unsatisfied spirit in the world today. People are just unsatisfied with their lives. They're unsatisfied with the politics, with, you know, with their jobs, they're unsatisfied with their lives. No one's ever seemed to be happy. Paul said, no matter what state I am, there I'm going to be content, amen? Because why? Because he had Christ as the center of his life. He knew Jesus was the center of his joy. You know, I was thinking about that song, you know, Jesus is the center of my joy. We sang this joy a moment ago, and I was thinking about, you know, I was thinking, Sandy must have kind of heard when I was going to preach this morning. She's talking, because I was thinking about, you were talking about joy, you came in here, and you didn't feel that right away, but then you did as you were here, and that's kind of what God was speaking in my heart. I guess this message could be, you know, what is the center of your joy, or, but really, I guess it would be, what did I say? Only God can satisfy. Amen? But only God can satisfy the longing of your heart and in your life and give you joy and peace. And, you know, we could go on and talk about all the scenarios, but I don't know about you, but everywhere I go and all the people, even around my family and everybody, I just, when I'm with them sometime, when I'm at work and I'm out in the crowds and I'm with people, I want to say, if you just embrace Jesus, if you just taste and see that he's good, if you just keep trying it, not just this little sip once in a while and put them back in the refrigerator. Just drink out of him every day.
Yes.
If you just drink from him every day, it's like, don't you want to, you want to almost shake him sometimes and say, no, not in anger, but just say, don't, if you could just do that.
Yes.
He would truly keep you going.
Yes.
He would truly satisfy you.
Amen.
And then they give you all their excuses and all their reasons of this and all the reasons of that. And I see in my heart, and I feel it even in my own life sometimes, but you know what? We're in a valley of indecision. You know, where, you know, it's like in the book of Joshua, you know, about, you know, there, you can do this and you can do that. And you know, we need to make a decision and say, as for me and my house, I'm going to serve the Lord. You know, we all got to make a choice. And the choices that we make affect our lives every day. The choices that we make affect our happiness, our joy, our peace, our all the things that we face is in the decisions that we make. I've heard it said before, but we gotta, you know, we gotta be responsible for the choices we make, right? And we do sometimes. And you know, I was thinking about, I got a friend from work the other day called me up, and it just, you know, I felt so bad for her, and she had texted me. I didn't know who it was because I'd lost some of my contacts from a while back, and then she ended up telling me who she was, and, you know, her sister had died unexpectedly the day before, or a couple of days before that, and they weren't really going to have a big funeral, but, you know, just wanted to know if I could come and pray with them, and I felt honored to do that, but, you know, I just want to say that, you know, I don't know why, but I seem like, I know, and I've said this before, not Reagan, and really it's an honor for me, but it's, some reason it feels like God is, I sometimes call myself the person that helps somebody as they're crossing through. You know, sometimes it seems like God puts me in that place to help people where they're losing someone or they've lost a loved one, to help them as they cross over to the other side. And as I went into that room and as people were standing there and as we were praying together, my thought was, God, what they need more than anything is you. What they need in this moment is you. And that was my prayer. I just, Lord, let them feel you. Let them call out to you. Let them know that you love them. Let them feel your power. Let them feel your peace. Let them drink from the living fountain of living water. Amen. Lord, let them desire you. Lord, what they need right now is more than anything else. They need your spirit. They need your comfort. They need your guidance. They need your help. They are hurting. They are confused. They don't know what to think, because sometimes you just don't know what you think when you're in that position. But that was my prayer, and as I left out of there, I felt like God helped me pray that prayer effectively. I had a young man that was in that group, and that finding me on Facebook and wanted to know if he could be a friend of mine. So I accepted him as my friend, and the next day he just said, I just want to thank you, Chris Savoy. And I'm not trying to, he said, just for being there for my family when we need you. You always seem to be there. And I just said, I'm just glad I was able to be there and help you out and point you to the Lord, and that you would draw strength from God. That's the only reason I was there. Not for me, not to make a name for myself, but that is what people need today. Amen. They need his power. They need his presence. They need his spirit in their lives. I didn't walk away feeling happy about anything. I felt sad. I felt broken. But I felt like Jesus could mend all that. Amen. Jesus could mend all of that. Jesus could put all of that together. In the psalmist, he says here in verse, in chapter 84, in verse 1, and I'm going to try to get through this psalm, and I'm reading out the New Living Translation. He says here, how lovely it is your dwelling place, O Lord Almighty. He said, how lovely is your dwelling place. How lovely. He said, I long, yes, I faint with longing to enter the courts of the Lord. With my whole being, body, and soul, he said, I will shout joyfully to the living God. He said, I long to be in that place, O God, of your dwelling. I long to feel your presence, Lord. And, you know, I was thinking this morning, Lord, I want to long, whether I'm here at church or whatever it is, but God, let me long to be in your presence. Let me have that desire that I want to be with you more than I want to be with anything, anyone, even my wife or my kids. That's what we need, amen? That's that place of saying, I need that. And I was thinking about the church today in general, you know, and I thought, where are people at? What is going on? Where is their longing? Where is their desire? Where is their hunger at? What are they longing for? The psalmist says, I long to be in God's presence. I long to be with God's people. I long to be in God's house. He said, I'm thirsty for that. And as I was reading this, and as I was thinking about what I was thinking about, I was thinking, as I was praying, I was saying, oh God, help them to start thirsting and hungering for you again. There seems to be such a people are just been disassociated with God. There seems to be a nonchalant, whatever shall be, shall be. What if I go to church today, I go. If I don't, I don't. It doesn't. Now, don't get me wrong. We all have struggles and sicknesses and things come up every single day. We out of this church because of little Nicole. But, you know, my heart is here. And when I can be here, I get my foot in the door. You know what I'm saying? And that's how it should be. And yet, I'm not pointing the finger at anyone, but it seems to be the state of the whole country. There seems to be such a melancholy of whatever, I don't care, you know, whether I go or whether I don't, because they're really not hungering and satisfied with the things of God anymore. Right. And now, I know I don't normally preach hard like that. I'm not trying to point the finger at anybody. But I think this day and age that we live in, this time of turmoil and all the things you hear on the radio and TV about, there's never been a time of election like this. And are we going to go into some sort of civil war? And is this going to take place? And that's going to take place? And all I can see is so many unsatisfied. They're so unsatisfied. There's no peace in their lives. There's no joy in their hearts. There's no contentment any longer. What gives me my peace, what gives me your happiness, is knowing Jesus Christ. Amen? That's what's going to keep you every single day. Whether you go to church or you don't, what really matters is your ongoing relationship with God. All when we come here, we collectively just lift up His name and give Him glory and praise, and we're like, get like a little energized bunny. We get out the door and we say, hallelujah, I can face this week again, amen? And the devil, he will do all he can to keep you from getting here, even when you're feeling okay. He knows what goes on when you get with God's people. I really believe that with all my heart. He'll fight us tooth and nail because He doesn't want us to have joy. He doesn't want us to have happiness. The psalmist said the key to being this is dwelling in God's presence. The key to having this is staying with God's in God's house. He says, I long, yes, I faint with longing to enter the courts of the Lord with my whole being, body, and soul. And I wrote a few other verses down that came to me that I was looking at. Psalms 36:8 said, they shall abundantly be satisfied with the fatness of thy house, and thou shalt make them drink of the river of pleasure. Hallelujah. He said, they shall be abundantly satisfied, and they shall be filled with the fatness of thy house. Amen. He said, and you shall make them drink of the river of pleasure. Hallelujah. That's, you know, I get excited, but I really believe that with all my heart. What satisfies me, what gives me my pleasure, what gives me my joy is drinking from Jesus, staying in His Word, going to God in presence, being in His presence. There's nothing else that can take its place. And people are trying to put other things in the place of what only Jesus can do. It's so sad. If I can get another tablet, if I can get on the computer and go here, if I can get to this and I can get to that, and if I have this house or that house, if I can go on vacation, if I can do this, if I can do that, if I can just take one more trip, and then they get there to the destination and they find themselves coming back as unsatisfied as when they first went. It's good for a little while, but it doesn't last. So they got to do something else again to kind of fill themselves back up, and then it empties out again. But not with Jesus. If you stay with Him, you can be in a little hut somewhere and feel His presence. You can just have just you and that's it, walking down the street and feel His glory, amen? You can look, like I said this morning, you can look on outside and say, wow, what an awesome God. I don't need to go camping to experience this. I might need to get up a little earlier in the morning. I might have to take a drive out to a state park somewhere that's all over the place. I can just go down here on River Drive, and I can see God's presence, look at the river, look at the colors. Hallelujah. That makes me happy? Yeah, because I feel God's presence. I know it's God talking to me. I see, you know, He's the one that gives me my peace of mind. He's the one that helps me sleep at night. He's the one that heals my body. He's the one that meets my needs. He's the one that I run to when I'm in trouble. He's the one that's there for me when no one else is there. He's the one that stays there and sticks closer than a brother to me. When everyone else turns their back at me, Jesus is still standing there. He never leaves me. He never forsakes me. He says, lo, I will be with you always, even until the end. And that's where we get our joy. As a Christian, that's where we get satisfied. We can't lose our sight on that. That we can't lose our place. I really believe this is what this psalmist was writing about. He said here, he said, my whole, I like this verse, in verse 2, the end part of it. It says, I will shout, it says, I'm sorry, I'm reading it. I long, yes, I faint with longing to enter the courts of the Lord. He said, with my whole being and body and soul. And I was thinking about, he said, with my whole being, with my body, and with my soul. He said, I'm putting everything in there. I'm putting my being in there. I'm putting my body in there. I'm putting my soul in there. I remember the verse came to me when I read that, and I was thinking of the verse that Jesus said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your what? With all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. You got to put it all kit and caboodle into Jesus. Amen. You can't say, I'm going to serve Jesus, but not on this day I'm not. I'm going to give so much of this to Jesus, but then I'm not going to give him no more. You got to give Jesus everything, your whole being, your whole life. Everything needs to be given to him. And then that's where the satisfaction comes. Well, I'm going to hang on to part of this. And you know, and I'm not saying you got to just, God works on us. He works on, you know, he works on us getting rid of struggles and desires and things like that. But it's just got to be a willing heart to say, Lord, here I am. Here's my life. Here it is, God. You take it. You do whatever you need to do with me and change me, God, and make me into your own, Lord, and make me a vessel of honor for you, oh God. That's what God is looking for. He's looking for a heart that's after his today. He says here, even the sparrows finds a home there, and the swallow builds her nest and raises her young at a place near your altar, and the O Lord Almighty, my King and my God. He said that even the birds and the swallows, he said, they find their nests near the place of God. They know where God is, and you know, you look at the trees as I was talking about them. He said, but even there, the birds have a nest. They make their home there. They pierce their lives there. God takes care of them there. And he said, how much more if we'll trust God with our own lives, with our vessels, with the things of our lives, will God take care of us? He says, how happy are those who can live in your house, always singing your praise. I was thinking about how happy. How happy are those who live in your house, always singing your praise. You know, this is the house of the Lord. The Bible says, know ye not that you are the temple of the Holy Ghost. That our house is the house of the Lord. That's where our happiness is in our lives, is when we put Jesus in our lives. And we make our home, our hearts, for him. And that's what the psalmist says. That's where my happiness comes from, is putting Jesus in my house. Always singing your praise. He said, happy are those who are strong in the Lord. Happy, he said, happy are those that have God in their hearts. Happy are those who are strong in the Lord. That's where our happiness comes from, is Jesus. Amen. My happiness doesn't come from, you know, I get happiness. Don't get me wrong. God, you know, don't take me wrong here, but God gives us happiness through our kids, through our family, through our relationships. But it all comes from the Lord. It's all from God. And my happiness isn't in the things I do. I enjoy doing them, but does that make sense? My happiness is in Jesus. He's, you know, whether I go outside and, you know, I get to play baseball or I don't, that doesn't make me happy. I might enjoy doing that, or if that's what I could do, but I can't do that no more. But, you know, what I think makes me happy, God uses those things. He blesses me with those things. But my happiness is in God. My joy is in the Lord. My peace is in Jesus. I don't look to the world to try to make me happy. If I look to the world to try to make me happy, I know I've been there. I wasn't happy. Do you see people trying to make themselves happy in the world? And they're not happy. I don't, you know, the word happy here, and the other word is blessed. God will bless those whose house is the Lord. God will bless them. God will provide for them. God will take care of them. In the New Living Translation, it says, happy are those that made God their house. And so I've realized, and I've come to realize, that my happiness is in Jesus, in Jesus only. He's my provider. He meets all my needs. He satisfies all my longings and my happiness. And then he goes on to say here, he says, happy are those that are strong in the Lord. He said, happy are those that are strong in the Lord. Or you could say, those that are strong in the Lord are happy. Amen. You can turn it around either way. He said, but blessed are those that are strong in the Lord, he said, who set their mind on a pilgrimage to Jerusalem. Hallelujah. He said, happy are those that set their mind on their pilgrimage. I don't know about you, but the Bible says that we are just strangers passing through. We are just pilgrims. Do you know that verse? We're just pilgrims passing through, not to get attached on this world. And why can we be happy? Because we don't need this world to make us happy. We know where our home is. We know what it says at the end of the book. We know where our dwelling place is. That's what keeps us happy. Those that keep their mind on Christ will make them happy. Set your mind on things above, not on things of the earth. Jesus said, that'll keep you happy. Amen? And that's our happiness, our pilgrimage. We're on a journey. We're on a quest today. He said, happy are those that their pilgrimage is on a journey of Jerusalem or Zion. Our happiness is in Christ today. I've got a vision in my heart. I've got a dream that's been planted inside of me by the Holy Spirit. I feel this wooing sometimes, even though I've not been there. There's a part of me sometimes that feels like I have. You know what I'm saying? It's like I can touch glory sometimes. I feel it. I'm like, ooh, there. Ooh, I get it. Ooh, I'm getting it. Ooh, I'm getting it. I'm getting a glimpse of it again. Ooh, I'm feeling it. It's that little. I know some of you wonder, but some of you know what I'm talking about. It's that little saucer blessing that comes from the Holy Spirit. It says, yes, there's eternal river flowing. There's something greater than this, Chris. There's a celestial life out there with God's angels and cherubims and all those that have won out before us are cheering us on. A great cloud of witnesses and all the angels in heaven are wooing and hooving over us. Yes, there is a pilgrimage. There is a city called Zion that you belong to. That's where you are getting your joy from. That's where you are connected to. That's what keeps you going, baby. That's what keeps the river flowing in your life, because you are connected to the vine. You are connected to that pilgrimage. You're connected to that citizenship. When you've asked Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior, not only did he forgive you and wipe the slate clean, but you were inherited into a wonderful gift. The Paul said, we inherited something that we could not even contain or imagine. Paul said, you don't even know the treasure. I don't know if I'm going anywhere. You don't even know the treasure that you have inside of you. The best is yet to come. If you just realize that what you're going through now is nothing compared to what you're going to get later on. And that's your happiness. That's your joy. Not in, not even in your health sometime. Not even in your wealth sometime. And all those things bring us temporal happiness and joy. But when it's all said and done and the pieces are falling all around us, our real happiness is in Jesus Christ. Our real strength is in God. Our real connection is in him. And he comes and tells us, I've died for you. I've shed my blood for you. I rose for you. I've got a plan for you. I've got something great than all this that's going on in your life. You just hang on to me and I will fill you in the moment, in the middle of where you're at. I can still fill you with happiness. Hallelujah. I can still fill you with my peace. He goes on to say here, he says in verse 7, he says, happy are those who are strong in the Lord, who set their mind on the pilgrimage to Jerusalem, the city of blessing. When they walk through the valley, and the King James says Baca, it really just means a valley of weeping. When they walk through a valley of weeping, though they're walking through it, he means, he said, it will become a place of refreshing springs. He said, when they're walking through the valley of weeping, I feel this morning. Some people have been walking through weeping. They've been walking through a valley of struggle. They've been walking through a valley of pain. They've been walking through a valley of struggle and hurt and let down and setbacks. He said, but the psalmist says, when you're walking through that, it will become a refreshing spring in your life. God will make that trial a blessing. That's what the psalmist is saying here. He said, and where pools of blessing collect after the rains. Woo! Hallelujah. He said, after it rains, after you've walked through that, God's going to turn that thing around that's been a cesspool of discouragement and hurt, and he's going to make it a blessing. There's going to be a blessing inside of that. He says here, For this cause, Paul said, we faint not, in 2 Corinthians 4:16. For this cause, we faint not. But though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. Though the outward man perish, for this cause, for that cause, for Jesus, for this reason we get strength, for this reason we go on, for this reason, positive, for this cause, though the outward man perish, because it's going to, the world is perishing, our bodies are perishing. I've been feeling it lately. I've been working out in the garage yesterday trying to hang some wood. And I told Lynn, I got to get back to exercise. And I could hardly stand up when I was done. My feet ate me all night long, ate me again this morning. I'm reminded I'm getting older. Amen. No matter what I try to do, I'm getting older. My body is perishing. But the inward man is being renewed. Hallelujah. He said, it is being renewed. He said, day by day. For our light affliction, he paused, this is what's happening here. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, it's just for a little time compared to eternity. It might seem like a long time, but it's just a moment when it's compared to eternity. When it's compared to forever, it's just a moment. It's just a time. It's just a season. He said, but it's just for a moment. Worketh for us a far more exceedingly eternal weight of glory. Really, he's saying the exact same thing that the psalmist said. He said, this thing that you're going, this valley that you're walking through, he said, is working towards something far more exceedingly valuable, something far more weighty, something that can outshine the thing you're going through by and by, there's no way you can compare what you're going to what God is going to do through that struggle, through that blessing. He's working through us a far more exceedingly blessing. There's something greater happening in your struggle. There's something, I know I preach a lot on these, and this seems like this is my life right now where God has me. And I don't know why I'm in this season, but God says, through this struggle, through this pain, through the things you're going through, it's not time to hang the harp, amen? It's not time. You might be weeping and crying, but joy comes in the morning. You might be going through something and wondering why I'm going through it, but there's something far more exceeding happening in your life. There's something more eternal going on. Paul said, it's eternal, baby. It's eternal. You need to say that. This is eternal. This is eternal. There's evidence going on in my life that only God and maybe someone else will know when I'm far gone beyond me. But God is using this for eternal glory and blessings. He says, when I'm passing through this, he said, it's going to become a refreshing springs where pools of blessing collect after the rains. Hallelujah. And Proverbs 4:18 says, but the path of the just is as a shining light that shineth more and more unto the perfect day. Well, hallelujah. The path of the just, the right, the righteous are like a shining light that keeps shining brighter and brighter. The world might be getting dimmer. You might be physically feeling the elements of life, but I'm going to tell you, your spirit, man, is being renewed. It's stronger now than it was yesterday. You've got more going on than what the devil's been telling you all week long. You might be going through struggles right now and setbacks, but I want you to know God is getting you ready for something great in your life. I believe that with all my heart. We can let the devil succumb to us and say, oh, the world's so bad and I'm just so dissatisfied. Your only satisfaction is going to be in Jesus Christ. As the psalmist said at the beginning, he said, I long to be in the house of God. I long to be in the courts of God. I long to be with God's people. I long to spend my time in God's word. I long to have fellowship with Jesus. I desire to read his word. I desire to get deeper in God. There's no more longing anymore. Maybe there is, but from what I can see, people are so discontented, so unsatisfied. They're looking for everything else to fill them with joy that only comes from the springs of living water, which is Jesus. If we could just see that, but we've so disassociated ourselves with that we don't even know what it is to feel his presence any longer, to really get connected with our eternal pilgrimage. We need to get connected with our eternal pilgrimage. We are just passing through. We can't be hanging on to all this stuff. Paul said, you need to let it go. You need to let go of that baggage that's holding you down. You need to let that go and say, I'm going, baby. I'm praying you come if you want. I want you to, but I'm going. This ain't stopping me. This ain't going to hold me back. It's just temporary. It's just for a moment. It's just going to pass away here soon. I'm about ready to bust out of this place. God's going to do something great in this situation. You just knew how many times has God done that for you over and over again? Each one of us sitting here and whoever else, you know God's been doing things in your life. You've seen him do it before, but in that moment, you don't think so. The devil lies to you, then he comes to you, he tries to tell you this, he tries to tell you that. Our joy isn't going to God's house. Our joy comes from Jesus Christ. Our joy rests in his peace and in his presence. In his presence is fullness of joy. In his presence. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He said here, he said, they will continue to grow stronger and stronger. And each one of them will appear before God in Jerusalem. Ooh, I love that verse. And each one of them will appear before God. I can't wait for that day, Sister Sandy. I'm looking at him face to face. I don't know what I'll do. I'll probably fall out of my face. I don't know what I'll do. But all it says, I will appear before him. I will stand before him. I will look into his face. I will see my maker. I'll see the King of all glory. I'm going to be able to. There was a time when we couldn't because of all his splendorness. But the veil's been ripped in two and torn. And now we've been able to enter into the Holy of Holies. And because of the blood of Jesus, we are going to be able to stand before him, Joe, and without any condemnation, without any thought of not being right, because our righteousness is going to be in Christ. All that garbage and all that filth that's on us is going to be gone. And oh, what a day that'll be. What a day. We sing that. What a day. What a day. What a day that'll be. 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 When all we'll see Jesus and all his glory and all of his hosts. And no more pain. No more suffering. No more tears. No more sorrow. Our loved ones, we're there. Hope forever. That is our covenant. That is our hope. That's what continues us to push us forward. Not everything else around us. It should not be something around me that makes me satisfied. It should only be Jesus and Jesus only. He's the one that should satisfy me. And if he's not, then something is wrong with me. Because he should be my source. If I'm in him and he is in me. And if he's not, and if I'm not, then something's wrong. Because if I look at the word, and I stand on the word, and I look at the promises, it says everything in the promises that if I long for him, if I dwell in his presence, if I crave for him, I'm in Psalms 84, by the way, Joe, that I'll be satisfied if I long for the house of God. Amen? If I stand in his presence, and if I continue, I have my good days, I have my bad days, but if I continue on, he's going to keep me, he's going to help me, and he has already. That's been an amazing thing about it, is that he has already. When I think there's no hope for me, all of a sudden I turn around and say, wow, where did that storm go? Here I am laughing again. Here I am praising again. Here's another testimony. Here's something else. And I thought it was totally crazy, ludicrous. What am I doing in all this? Now I'm out of that. Here I am. And I say, wow, look at all the people God brought in. Look at all the things that God did. Look at all. And here I was. And sometimes in that, you start feeling, like I said, you start feeling that touch. You start feeling the connection. You start knowing, hey, I'm really not in this place. There's something bigger going on here than that's taking place. Amen. There's something bigger going on here. And you know that. And so I don't know why we got to go through things, but we do. But it brings God's glory. It does. And it's not the end. It's not the end. That's when you should know when you're going through things and you're going through struggles. You got to know that's what the Bible says, is that you're going to get stronger through it. You're going to get brighter through it. You're going to go through some things, but hang on, because the end's not yet. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. He says here, they will continue to grow stronger and stronger. Each one of them, each one of them. Each one of them. Are you one of them? I'm one of them, baby. I'm one. Each one of them will appear before God in Jerusalem. Oh, God Almighty, hear my prayer. Listen, oh, God of Jerusalem. Oh, God, look with favor upon the King, our protector. Have mercy on the one you have anointed. He says, I love this. We've heard songs about this. He said, a single day in your courts is better than 1,000 anywhere else. He said, a single day in York, a single moment with God is better than anywhere else. And that was the title of my message, Only God Can Satisfy. And if we could just get back to the place that we would learn to just spend a moment with God, a day with God, it will be more than anything else, 1,000 anywhere elsewhere. You can't give, you can't, God, you can't line something else up with God. You can't line something else up and say, God, or this. And when you really are walking in Him, when you're really feeling His power, God, or this, He will trump it every time. He will throw it down every time. He will overcome it every time. There's no joy. There's no peace. There's no happiness. There's no longing that will satisfy the soul like knowing Jesus Christ. Jesus said, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. He told the woman at the well, if you drink from me, baby, you will never thirst again. You've been drinking from this pool for a whole long, long time. But if you drink from me, I'm gonna put you to the test. You drink for me. And oh, baby, she drank. She was drinking. Woo! Come down. Let me show you about a man. Let me show you, Suzanne. Let me show you about the man that changed my life. That's what happened to her. She put him to the test. She tasted and she went running. Woo! Hallelujah. Well, let me tell you about Jesus. Well, we can just get like that when we walk out the door. Woo! Let me tell you about the man. Let me tell you who I've been with this morning. Let me tell you what we drank from this morning. Let me tell you where I've been. I've been in some struggle. I've got some reports from the doctors. But that doesn't matter because Jesus is my King. He's my Lord. This place is not my home. I know I've got something greater and prepared for me. God may be using this to bring glory to His life so you can be affected by it, that maybe it'll draw you to your knees. Hallelujah. Oh my God, a day in your courts is better than 1,000 elsewhere. Why is it when we read this and we sing this song, it seems like somehow or another we get off the path and we get back on track and lose track of where that place is better than anywhere else? I don't understand it because I go through it myself sometimes. But oh God, as I was praying this morning, let me not forget that being with you is greater than anything else in my life. That only you can truly satisfy the longings and the cravings of this soul. And you can only satisfy the craving of my children, God. Only you can satisfy them. Oh, you listen to their stories. You hear all the things they say. But deep down, don't you lose sight of the only one that can really touch them. The only one that can satisfy them is Jesus. And if you can't say it to them, pray it for them. Pray it into their hearts. Pray it into their lives. Sometimes saying things isn't going to help, but let the Holy Spirit get a hold of them. Let the hot dog of heaven, as Pastor Ron says, get a hold of them. Oh, He'll speak into their hearts, especially if they had a relationship with Jesus. He will remind them once in a while. He'll tickle on them. He'll pull their hair a little bit. He'll chasten them a little bit. He does it in love, but He'll remind them. Oh, don't you remember that experience? Don't you remember that time? Oh, taste of me a little bit more. Taste of me a little bit more. Let them see you keep drinking from Him. Let them see you keep tasting Him. Let them see you keep experiencing Him. And they, you are just going to be a testimony to them. Come, whatever in your life, you're going to show them, this is what kept mom, this is what kept dad, this is what kept grandma, this is what sustains me. He's my provider. He's my El Shaddai. He's my everything. There is nothing else in the medicine cabinet or at the Walgreens that can help me. Only Jesus can help me. That doesn't mean that you can't take something from Walgreens or the medicine. I'm just using it as a phrase. I took some ibuprofen yesterday. And it's a prayer. Hallelujah. Yeah. But you know, I heard it so. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your courts. Better. And I was singing that song. I was like, God, help us not to sing that haphazardly. Yeah. Help us to really mean it when we sing it. Better is one day in your courts. One day in your presence. One day in the house of the Lord, with God to be one hour here is better than anywhere else. better than any Big Mac, any meal, anything I'm going to experience, any football game, any extra hour in bed, better than anything, not just here, but tomorrow morning, better than one moment with you, God, is better than anything else I'll do, because that's where the true blessings come from, that's where your happiness comes from, that's where your peace comes from, that's where your hope comes from, that's where your strength comes from, that's what's going to help you put on the whole armor of God, because there's a horde of hell coming at you every day, and the devil doesn't want you to do that, but if you get in his presence and spend a little time in his courts, I guarantee you, you come out snapping and happy, and the joy of the Lord will be your strength. I've heard Pastor Dave Wilkerson say this before, when you get in his presence and you get in and lost in his power and spend some time with him, oh, the situation might not change, but the circumstance in your mind, and your mind will change, the way you perceive it, the way you look at it, it will change, because God gives us a renewed mind, a renewed spirit. He gives us, the inward man is renewed day by day. We are renewed. What does that mean, renewed? I don't know about you, but when my laptop starts getting low, I got to plug it in. Well, we got cords in our car. Oh, my phone's going dead. Plug it in. Oh, this is going slow. I got to get a new cord. I got to get a new power amp. Some of us need some new power injectors in our lives, amen? We need to plug it. We need to say, plug in to Jesus, amen? Plug in. Keep the power supply high in God. And everything else runs low, keep that high. And you will not be unsatisfied. You will be full of joy. You'll feel His